Hello, and welcome back to our interview with the astounding Mike Cole, a man who is both more jock and more nerd than I will ever be. If you're just tuning in now, make sure to go back and watch the first half of the interview. And if you've already seen it, here we go. So this question might be a little odd, and I don't know, I might end up editing it out. Why did you have the main character of Control Point being hunted by the military?
Because, I think, for me, I have always wanted to belong. I think that is one thing that is unusual for me. I think a lot of nerds, or most nerds I know, are mavericks, and they're interested in shrugging off institutions. I've always wanted to be accepted by institutions and approved by them. That's the people ask me, why don't you self-publish? I don't want to self-publish. I want a big New York publishing house to tell me I'm good enough to write for them. That means something to me. It's visceral. And one of my biggest fears is having institutions that I value and I want to be a part of reject me and tell me I'm not good enough. Those are the kinds of anxiety dreams I have. And so exploring what happens when an institution you love not only rejects you, but determines you to be a pariah and brings its the full weight of its approbation against you. That's a pretty heady thing for me, and I think subconsciously I was trying to tackle that head on.
And so you've been working on Shadow Ops since grad school, while Sacred Throne is a lot more classic fantasy style, you know, medieval and whatnot. What made you decide to make that shift?
So, you start out this interview saying, Mike Cole is, you know, authentically in the military, and also, well, you called me famous, I will debate that, fantasy writer.
Well, I mean, I definitely heard of you, I'd seen ads for your books.
I'll take it. Is a fantasy writer and in the military. And I got a lot of praise for the military authenticity in my work. And every interview I went to, Mike, when you wake up in the morning and have a military breakfast and go for a military run and then, you know, sit down and do your military work, how does that military feel? And you start to reach a point where you ask yourself, are people praising my work because it's authentically military? Or are people praising my work because it's good? And that became a grain of sand under my shell, and I started to develop this like pathological need to prove to myself and my readers that I could do more, and that I wasn't just a one-trick pony. And I'm lucky, because that grain of sand became the pearl that is the armored saint. That was the most satisfying experience. And look, that book took me 3 years to write.
Really?
I had failed attempt after failed attempt after failed attempt. My agent disliked that book so much he wouldn't take it out to sell. In the end, I actually had to sell it myself. I was very lucky that one of my beta readers and good friends became a consulting editor at Tor, Justin Landon. He believed in the book and reached out to me and said, look, if you'll cut this down to our length, you know, maybe we can look at it again. And he's an excellent editor. He was really able to bring the best of the story out in that book.
And there's a lot of best there.
Well, thank you. For me, it was like, I can't tell you, I had this incredible nagging insecurity about my ability as a writer, that I could not do this thing. And this insecurity is being reinforced by failure after failure after failure, 3 years on this thing. It didn't take me 3 years to write it. I had that thing written in like 8 months. It was 3 years of like, you know, editing, failing. To finally have it sell. And then not only sell, but excite the publishers so much that they put real muscle behind it and receive such critical acclaim. I can't describe to you how good that felt.
One of the things that I mentioned in my review was that you're very willing to hurt Eloise.
Eloise?
Eloise. You're
By the way, I say this not to you, but your readers. Once a piece of writing leaves my desk, it no longer belongs to me. It belongs to you.
Definitely.
So if it's Alois to you, then it's Alois. I don't have any problem with that. All I'm telling you is what I thought in my head when I pronounced that name. All
right. You're very willing to hurt her in a way that I don't think even Martin or Abercrombie I don't think I've ever seen any author do that in story. I mean, Sandan Glockta, maybe, but he's, you know, beforehand.
That's Carl Shivers, and Besser Cole. The thing I love about his arc is that here is an evil character who wants to become good, and the universe won't let him.
Yeah.
And it's the most cruel thing, realizing that he will never rise above his villainy.
So where do you think that willingness to hurt your own main character came from? And actually, side question, where did Oz come from in the first place?
Helwaz came from, I think, really Aliens 2. She came from Aliens 2, and she came from Warhammer 40K. Aliens 2, if you remember the scene where Ripley gets in that loader, that exoskeleton loader, and takes on the Queen. And I was so struck by the idea that with the aid of a machine, this tiny little lump of flesh could challenge this clearly physically superior thing and win. The other thing was, I'm a huge fan of the Warhammer 40K universe. Huge fan. So much so that I actually almost wound up under contract writing for Black Library, which is the fiction arm of Games Workshop, to writing Warhammer 40K. The contract, look, and this is not a knock on Black Library, I love them to death. I could not work under the contract terms that they offer. So I had to, you know, and they were happy to have me. We were going to do this. But, you know, I could not accept those contract terms, so I had to walk. One of the things I noticed about the Warhammer 40K universe, and Dan Abnett remedies this somewhat in his Eisenhorn Quartet, is that you never see what life is like when people are not fighting. Never. It's this incredibly rich universe. You know, what are Space Marines like when they take their goddamn armor off? You know,
do we even know if they can?
Who knows? Maybe they can. You know, what are Imperial Guardsmen like, you know, before they go to muster? You know, what are the people in the Hive worlds like? What are the people in the Forge worlds like? What are their lives like when they get off work? That Black Library does not answer those questions pretty much ever, with the exception of Eisenhorn, the four book series from so far from Dan Abnett, which I highly recommend. It's excellent.
We'll include the links to those in below.
And I really wanted to explore that. And I wanted to get as far from the archetype of the giant male space marine and a little girl is as far as you get. And I also try in every single one of my books, I always do this, to stretch the envelope and to write outside of my voice and push my voice as far as I can. I will say this. You may not like my books, but you cannot say I'm rubber stamping them. Control Point is nothing like Fortress Frontier. It's nothing like Breach Zone. It's nothing like Gemini Cell. It's nothing like Javelin Ring. The protagonist of Control Point is an African-American Army helo pilot in Vermont. The protagonist of Siege Line is an Athabascan Chippewyan Dene sheriff of an isolated town in Fort Resolution in the Northwest Territories of Canada. I have a sex scene from the point of view of a woman, which is an incredible challenge to write, in Gemini Cell. And it's on purpose that I did it that way, to stretch myself, to test myself. And that's another reason why I chose a young girl to be the protagonist here. That's where she came from. Now, in terms of hurting her, I don't want you to think that's easy for me.
I've done some writing. I know how difficult it can be to hurt a protagonist.
Right. I mean, I love Elwaz, and I want good things for her. Look, man, I spent my entire life in law enforcement, in intelligence, in the military, downrange, in prisons, on patrol, world's pretty nasty. And it's not nice to little girls. And all good fiction raises the stakes. All good fiction, and a character's ability to triumph, the resonance of that comes in proportion to the adversity they experience. But I don't want to sugarcoat the world. I want my fantasy worlds to reflect the world that I know. And then maybe the hope that the characters can mine from it will be that much more resonant to my readers.
That was beautiful. Now you mentioned that that Arid Saint was inspired in a way by Warhammer 40,000.
Not in a way.
Yeah.
Like totally. It is a love letter to Warhammer.
That's actually what my next question was going to be. I was a little worried about asking that because I thought I might offend you.
Oh.
There's so many similarities. Oh. With the
deliberate.
What with the Emperor.
Yes,
the dead
of
Emperor,
course.
Who everyone worships. The wizards who become demons if they go too far.
Yes.
And you. We've already confirmed that the power armor is
yes.
Nessus Astartes.
Yes, all of it true. all of it true. And if you, people said this about Control Point, the Shadow Ops series, Pete gave me the quote, Peter B. Brett gave me the quote, Black Hawk Down meets the X-Men. And the character of Scylla, who is very, very clearly Magneto, very clearly. And I've had, again, interviewers or friends or whatever be like, you know, she kind of reminds me of Magneto. And I'm like, yeah, that's because I stole the character from Magneto. You know, bold face. Look, despite whatever contractual issues I may have had with Black Library, the Warhammer 40,000 universe is one of the great universes in fantasy. It is such a brilliant idea. And the Warhammer Fantasy universe. I will never get tired of those games. I will never get tired of those books. And I really wanted to honor that influence. But I wanted to honor it in my own way. I wanted to look at village life. I wanted to look at quotidian life. So yeah, what you're seeing is an absolute unbridled homage.
Side note, would you consider it a possibility that the Sacred Throne takes place in the Warhammer 40K universe on a planet that's been cut off from the rest of the Imperium?
No, absolutely not. I'm fine acknowledging my influences from other works of fiction, but this is my world, and you'll see in The Queen of Crows and you'll see in The Killing Light that it goes in very, very different directions.
Okay, I'm definitely looking forward to that. I will have to get a copy of
Queen
of
Crows. Well, I'll get you a copy.
Oh, that would be great.
Don't get a copy when I get ARCs. I actually have two of them right here, those are I keep two of every edition of everything I publish.
You know what? If you can get me an ARC, I'd be happy to review it.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, I'll have my publicist send it to you as soon as you'll write the email before you leave.
Oh, that would be fantastic.
My pleasure.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Let's see. So next up. So you've written a lot about how history and warfare and fiction interplay. Have you ever considered writing a guide for, like, to military and military history for writers?
Man, no. And also, I don't know that I would be qualified to do that. You gotta remember that, like, I have been to war. I have been shot at. I have been blown up. I've had those experiences. But I don't want to mislead people into thinking that I was ever a frontline combat arms specialist. That is not what I did. I was an intelligence officer. I certainly went out. I certainly was in danger. But I think the guide you're describing would probably be better written by a Marine rifleman who'd been on the streets of Fallujah, you know, during the attempts to take it. I'm not trying to downplay my experience, but good writing about war needs to come from the emotional experience of battle. And I have an emotional experience of battle. I've been in it. But I wouldn't hold my experience up to, say, the experience of, like, a Navy SEAL or an infantryman in a Striker Brigade combat team. that's the person I think should write the book you're describing.
Okay. But you're a bit of a military historian yourself.
I can finally lay claim to the term historian. My first book of military history, nonfiction, is coming from Osprey in the fall. I'm praying that that book sells well enough that I get to do more, because boy do I love this topic. And I found a niche. I found an area of military history where there's very little written, almost nothing. It's amazing. If you want to read about Alexander the Great from a military perspective, go into a Barnes & Noble. You will never get through all the books they have. You will die before you could read them all. You want to read about Caesar crossing the Rubicon and the end of the Roman Republic? Forget it. Couldn't get through all the stuff that's written. But you got 270-odd years between the death of Alexander and Caesar crossing the Rubicon. And nobody cares. No one's written anything. There's like
Seriously?
Two... Yeah.
There's nothing on the Punic Wars?
There's like... The Punic Wars, yes. I'm talking about the successor wars. I'm talking about... the Seleucids and the Antigonids, I'm talking about Philip V, I'm talking about Antiochus III, I'm talking about the Ptolemies, and there is some serious Game of Thrones stuff going on. Backstabbing, and marriages, and betrayals, and incredible conflicts. Nobody writes anything. There's like maybe two or three books in English written by modern historians. So I found this area where I have a lot to say. And now after writing, the act of researching this first book, I now have some authority. Like, I now understand this topic and have read the sources and taught myself the material to the point where I have more to say, and I have the foundation from which to say it. So I'm really, really hoping to continue writing history. It's been an incredible experience.
What with your new, I wouldn't say, well, I'm not sure you might agree with me if I said expertise, but authority, I suppose. Have you thought about... Making more fiction / fantasy series set in that kind of.
So it's funny you should say. So right now I'm writing The Killing Light, which is the third book in the Sacred Throne trilogy. I have a new contract with Angry Robot to do two books, military science fiction, about the Coast Guard, the future of the Coast Guard doing operations on the moon, in the future.
The hell of a coast.
And the first book in that series is going to be called SAR 1, and that is due for me in December. That will be published after that. Once I complete all those contracts, I do have an idea, sort of along the lines of what you're describing, but it's alternate history. So I'm going to take an historical event and ask the question, what if it went this way?
Those are always fun.
In the tradition of a Harry Turtledove, right. I don't want to say anything yet, because again, this is years in the future. Future me will have to solve this problem. But that is going to be the next project I tackle once I fulfill all my projects, my contracts.
That sounds amazing.
Thanks.
So do you have any, aside from joining the military, do you have any particular advice for writers, people who are...
Yes, I have so much advice for writers. And whenever I give advice for writers, I'm really giving it to myself. It's always things that I struggle with, and that I'm trying to tell you so that you will have an easier time of it than I do. Hint, you will not have an easier time of it, because it's never easy. The first is that, character over plot. People are interested in other people. That's it. That's all we care about. A book with amazing characters and a wooden plot is a good book. A book with a great plot and wooden characters is a bad book. And I really firmly believe that. And focus on the characters' flaws. What makes them messed up? What makes Cersei Lannister fascinating is her tortured relationship with her own family. What makes Rick from The Walking Dead so compelling is the hell this guy has been through and how it twisted him and his child. And if you're looking for examples how people are screwed up, look at yourself, look at your family, look at the people around you. Because people are so flawed, and the people that are closest to you are going to have the flaws you know best. take those flaws, exacerbate them, accentuate them, and put them on the page. I really believe that. And then the next thing I'll say is, I have a tattoo on my forearm here, and it reads, "The sea doesn't care about you." Now that may seem cruel, but I think of it as a kindness. Because what I mean by it is, I get it. Writing is hard. The odds are long. There is a 99.9% chance that you will pour yourself into this discipline and have absolutely nothing to show for it. That is the likely outcome. And I get that it hurts. I get that it provokes anxiety. I get that it's frustrating. I get it. I get it. I get it. And the fastest way to get you out of that anxiety and out of that discomfort and to the goal you want to get to, which is published writer, is to sit your ass down and do the work. Less time like this, more time like this. And I don't mean that cruelly. I'm not saying the sea doesn't care about you and giving you that advice because I think your suffering is a joke or trivial. I don't. I see your suffering and I feel it myself. And I want you out of it. And the fastest way out of it is your ass in a chair and your fingers on a keyboard and less time complaining.
It's a hell of a way to put it.
Tough love.
Tough love. Yes, it works, right? Right. I think I'm actually out of questions.
Okay.
So, it was wonderful to speak to you.
Yeah.
It was lovely to meet you.
Yeah,
you have
too.
A lovely apartment and so many interesting books and games.
yeah, it's a pretty good dragon's hoard. It's too bad the camera can't convey to your readers how your viewers how small it is. We're in a shoebox, folks.
I can actually probably zoom out at some point.
No,
but
I don't want people to see the mess.
if you can't see, but there's a table right under the under the camera view angle with a board game that is just the Roman Republic in its entirety.
Yeah. Pax Romana from GMT Games. Try it out.
But yeah, so thank you for agreeing to meet with me.
Yeah,
thank you for having me in your lovely apartment.
Yeah.
And thank you so much for writing The Armored Saint. I loved it.
Well, thanks for reading it.
And I look forward to Queen of Crows.
Yep, I'll make sure I get you an arm.
Okay, that will be fantastic.
Right.
Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Thank you everyone for watching. Now, I have a special announcement. As promised, Mike Cole did manage to get me an advanced reader copy of The Queen of Crows, his upcoming book from Tor.com. It'll be out in October, but you're going to be getting an advanced review by next week on Saturday. In the meantime, if you enjoyed this video, make sure to show it by clicking the like button, and click here on the dragon to subscribe. Remember to watch the first part of our interview with Cole here, and I will see everyone next week. We should be putting up two videos. Until then, read good fantasy.